I'm Stuart Wallace. I'm the chair of a new global organization called WEAL, the Wellbeing Economy Alliance. I'll tell you a little bit about that in a bit. But I hope by now that all of you in this room are convinced we need a major shift in our economic system. We need a system shift, not just marginal change. And I hope you've also got some sense not just of the why that's needed, but what that might look like, the different elements. And obviously a lot of what we've discussed today has been exactly about that. But the big question that exercises me, and has exercised me for many years, is not the why, or even the what, but the how. And the fundamental question, I think, is how we make this system shift happen. We can spell out so clearly the different elements of it, we can spell out so clearly the reasons for it, but how is it going to happen? And for many years, for about 12 years in fact, I led the New Economics Foundation in London, and Miatta is now the chief executive of. And our model of change was groundbreaking, thorough research, backed up by fun, punchy communications, lobbying, campaigning with others, and trying out ideas and practice on the ground. And we achieved all sorts of successes. We were a successful organization. We also pushed new thinking and around areas like well-being. We're one of the pioneers of all the work on well-being, national accounts in Europe, the Happy Planet Index, and we really thought that we might bring about some shift in the system when we together with Layard and others, got the UK government, the UK Prime Minister, and the coalition government to start measuring well-being as a headline measure, training 400 top civil servants, etc. We thought that would shift things, measuring something differently. It didn't. And so for an organisation dedicated to system change, we didn't achieve that objective. And we weren't alone. There's been huge amounts of really excellent, thorough research, lots of good policy achievements, some great campaigns. There's lots of good exemplars, and you'll hear some of those on the ground about what a new economy might look like. All sorts of models out there. But they're not yet changing the system. And really the whole basis of what this panel is going to be about is how we do it. And that's what, you know, no pressure panel, but I'd like us, when we come out of the end of this session, for you to have a bit more clear idea of two things. One, that this change is possible, and secondly, that we have some view. Of course, we're all learning, we're all trying out things of how that might happen. But that's what our objective is. Now, the good news, and Eric's already talked about parts of this, as has the previous panel, is there were two shifts in major system shifts in the economic system in democracies in the global north in the 20th century. Because as well as a shift in neoliberalism in the late 70s, 80s, noughties, 90s, noughties, there was also a shift mid-century to Keynesianism, and a much greater focus on government intervention, health education, the role of the state in the mixed economy, etc. So, you know, both those shifts were major shifts. So it's happened twice before, it can happen again. The issue is how do we make it happen? Now we've got a wonderful panel. I'll talk through just briefly the bios of the panel in the running order. Michael Jacobs is Professor of Political Economy at the University of Sheffield and co-founder of the new Strategy and Communications Group that you've already heard about together with Laurie. Michael's experience of thinking about and working for political and economic change from three crucially different but reinforcing perspectives. First, as an academic economist, he wrote The Green Economy, which has been very widely cited, 1991. Ahead of your time, Michael.
Or very old.
Well, either, we'll live with it. He's now working, as I've already said, at the Sheffield Political Economy and Research Institute, SPERI, on paradigm shifts in economic theory and policy. The second hat Michael's been wearing for many years is an advisor to the UK Chancellor and the Prime Minister under the last Labour government. And he helped write the groundbreaking Climate Change Act, and the low carbon transition plan. And thirdly, wearing civil society hats, and amongst other hats there, has been director of the Fabian Society, helping devise the civil society strategy for the Paris Climate Agreement, and directing the recent IPPR, Institute for Public Policy and Research, Commission on Economic Justice, which produced the radical plan for economic reform in the UK last year. And it's well worth, if you haven't seen that, looking at that, because it's a great document. Next on my right, Miatta Fanbulle, okay, who's chief executive now of the New Economics Foundation, which is a London-based think and do tank and a leading organisation worldwide pushing for economic, social and environmental justice. And like Michael, Miatta has been at the forefront of work on political and economic change, inside government and out. Prior to NEF, she was director of policy and research at IPPR, I've already spelled what that is, and has worked at senior levels in the UK with the leader of the opposition, the cabinet office and the prime minister's strategy unit. Huge experience in areas like local economic growth, devolution, community empowerment, localism, climate change, energy, housing, and transport, to name a few. On my left here is Ronnie Galvin, who's recently appointed, about 8 months, I think, Ronnie, Vice President of Engaged Practice at Democracy Collaborative. Democracy Collaborative engages in on-the-ground campaigns to establish a new economic system where shared ownership and community control creates more equitable outcomes and promotes flourishing democratic and community life. And Ronnie's committed his life's work to community building, community organising and social change. And prior to joining Democracy Collaborative, he worked at the Centre for Community Change in Washington DC, focused on reinvestment in black communities that have been traumatised by the American political economy. And prior to that, he was the executive director for something called Impact Silver Spring in the Washington area. But he also brings the lens of African-centered spirituality to his work, and he's an ordained and practicing Baptist minister. So,
but I like to drink.
We'll allow that. Good. And last but not least, we've got an addition to what's put on the panel. We've got Gail, and Gail wasn't able to join the panel yesterday because she had a horrible allergic reaction. And I'm delighted to say she's back with us, alive and kicking. She's an associate fellow at the Syed Business School in Oxford. She's program director of Oxfam Impact Investing, co-founder of Women Transforming Leaders, and senior management director of PFC Social Impact Advisor. Without more ado, Michael.
Stuart said, why don't you just start by talking about what a different economic system would look like? We're going to talk about system change. We need to have some vision of what kind of alternative system we're aiming for. So I've been tasked with a rather ludicrous notion of giving you an idea of a different economic system in what is now only 6.5 minutes.
No, you can have 7.5.
It's very good that we're talking about systems. Most of our politics is conducted in terms of individual policies to deal with individual problems. And in most periods of human life and politics, that's about as far as the conversation ever goes, because the system itself is taken for granted, and it's difficult to imagine, as Eric said, a change in system as a whole. We're not in one of those moments. We're in a moment when the system is in question. And this is not just in question from people like us, but in question from the capitalists themselves. Big headline in the Wall Street Journal yesterday, page 2, capitalists worried about capitalism. Now, they're not trying to change the system, but they are very conscious that there are people who are questioning the system as a whole. And it's important that we do this. So this is the first thing to say is this is an auspicious moment for thinking more radically about the system as a whole. And it is, of course, a system as a whole. It is made up of different elements, but these combine to generate the outcomes that we are now so rightly anxious about. And yet there's a paradox here, because if you simply talk about systems, you end up in generalizations. You often end up using terms which not everybody understands. Capitalism itself socialism, which is now even a phrase one can utter in polite company in the US, it seems, which is quite a remarkable development. I don't think that's very helpful at this stage of the debate. So, in fact, I think we need to try and identify the different elements of the system that build up to create the system as a whole. And to do that, I think we need to start with the values that we want the economic system to express and promote, and the outcomes that we want it to achieve. The problems that led us to the situation where we're now questioning the system are a set of disastrous outcomes. And so we need to have an economy that rests on different values producing different outcomes. And I want to suggest that there are four overarching ones. They will be familiar to you and from the discussion we've had. And then I want very, very quickly just to say the kinds of institutional forms and structures that might generate those better outcomes and express those values. And this might be a way then of imagining what a new kind of economic system would be. So the first is environmental sustainability. We can argue exactly about what that means, but we have in some way to live within the planetary boundaries that are not given to human beings to determine for ourselves. We can affect them a little bit, but in the end we live in a biophysical system that operates according to the laws of thermodynamics and and within the natural processes. And we have to find a way of living within those. And environmental sustainability, planetary boundaries, is the term I shall use for those. And there are deep values expressed in the idea of doing that, because that is about appreciating what we have not made ourselves, and we've heard some expression of that in these last 2 days. Secondly, human well-being. I take this to be a general phrase to indicate that what makes a good life, a flourishing life for individuals, and what makes a healthy and flourishing society for us together is not something that can be reduced to income growth. That it is a multifaceted thing that consists of, for ourselves, our health, our purpose, our freedom from exploitation and our dignity. For our communities, it is about the sense of community that we have together, that it is the public goods that we enjoy. And a stronger, wider, broader sense of human well-being, which acknowledges that we both flourish as individuals and are members of a society which itself can flourish, and which is not simply made up of the aggregated flourishings of individuals, but has some form of itself, is the second crucial purpose. The third one is equity or justice. It matters how well-being is distributed, and a society in which there are gross disparities between different groups in society, both by income, by gender, by race, by geography, is not a good society or economy. And the fourth one is democratic. The fourth value is democracy, and I will explain why I think that's absolutely critical to this whole process. But it means that decisions in that economy are not simply made by economic actors acting as economic actors, but are made by societies trying to reach decisions which reflect the benefit in some sense of the whole society. So those are the four outcomes, if you like, the values that I think we need to be moving towards. And then I think the question of how you imagine a society which could achieve all of those things, it's helpful to go through those different four values and outcomes and think, well, what is it that would generate those? So let's start with environmental sustainability. There's a bunch of stuff here which is about the technologies and kinds of material flows which would occur in such an economy. You can only have a sustainable economy, we know, at zero net emissions. The climate science is absolutely clear about this, and we know we have to do that very quickly. We also know we have to find a way of limiting our extraction of natural, of renewable, life-based resources. We are destroying natural habitats and so on. We have to find a way of maintaining those at acceptable, sustainable levels. And we need a circular flow of materials through the economy. So there's a bunch of things which are about imagining how our economy will rest on its biophysical foundations. But then there's the question of what you will need to guarantee that that happens. And I think we have to face a really difficult understanding here, which is that there is no institution in a modern economy that can of itself guarantee sustainability, unless we make sustainability the legal basis on which we run an economy. Environmental sustainability will always be a function of externality. Even in institutions that are trying to do the right thing, no institution controls the aggregate. And these are aggregate impacts. There are some environmental impacts which are not aggregate. Toxic waste pollution produced by individual firms isn't. But greenhouse gas emissions, air pollution, the effect on soils and so on are aggregate impacts, and no individual institution controls the aggregate. So for me, there has to be some collective agreement, and I would say legal basis, on which we limit the aggregate impact of the economy. I've called for a Sustainable Economy Act and so on. So I think that's a really important function. Secondly, for sustainability, we need innovation. We have to have an economy that innovates. We are currently running a deeply, deeply unsustainable economy with the technologies and the forms of organisation, distribution, consumption that we currently have. We need innovation. So we need an economy that drives innovation, that rewards innovation, and doesn't reward simply extraction. A whole more we could say about that. Well-being, what generates well-being? Two things, I would say. The first is cultural. We need an economy that doesn't see the end of life as the consumption of more stuff, but as the flourishing of our capacities as human beings. I don't think that's all about what goes on in the economy. I think that's what goes on in our cultural institutions, in our minds, and so on. But we need to revalue things that matter. I think the core economic part of that is time. I think if we are spending as much time as we currently spend in our working lives, we are losing the time to do many other things. And I think the kind of economic system I would like to have would radically redistribute time between paid work, caring work, voluntary activity, artistic endeavour, and so on. Secondly, I think we need to acknowledge in well-being that our well-being is not simply made up of our consumption. Under the individualistic ideology and philosophy that Eric outlined this morning, we have got an idea that our well-being is a matter of what we consume as individuals, and it isn't. What we know from our natures and from what we see around us is that our well-being is deeply bound up with collective goods that we consume together. Clean air, a sense of security in our neighbourhoods, the protection of the natural environment. These are goods which are not individually consumed or produced, they are collectively consumed or produced, and we need to value those more and we need to pay for them, which means that our economy must generate the collective revenues to pay for things that generate well-being for us as a society. Thirdly, inequality. Whole bunch of different things here. I will pick two. Firstly, change relationships in the labour market. We have deeply unequal relationships in our labour market, and we will not, it seems to me, have a system which generates inequality unless we rebalance the power of employers and workers in the labour market. Secondly, we need to change ownership structures. We've had this massive distribution of national income from labour towards capital over the last 40 years. One of the ways of redistributing that is by increasing the power of labour to get reward, but the other one is to change the ownership of capital. And I think in any sustainable and just economic system, we will have firms and capital much, much more widely owned. I think there are a whole variety of ways of doing that. That will be a transition process, but I think that's going to be critical. And in the end, the finance capital is the most important part of this, because it's the finance capital that directs investment in our society. So a society and economy in which finance capital is in some sense socially owned or socially guided in a much, much stronger way than we have today, I think is going to be crucial. We have to deal with systematic institutional gender and race discrimination and inequalities. That is partly within the economy, but it's also within society more generally. And we need a tax system which is progressive, which gradually redistributes money away from the rich and from the very wealthy. And underpinning all of this, we need a set of minimum rights. Many things should not be in the market. We need to withdraw some of the things that are only available now through the market, and where therefore your income is the critical determinant of what you get. Education, healthcare for all, I would add another one, housing, should not be determined simply through the market. They should be determined through public provision, and they should. And this fourth thing is democracy. How are you going to get all of that to happen? And it seems to me that the critical thing is that we need a much stronger role for the democratic system and for the states that arise from the democratic system to help ensure that those things happen. In the end, an economy that works on market principles where how much money you've got and how much control you have and the power you have as a corporation or as a wealthy individual within a market, if that's where the decisions are being made, we will not get these things. We will, even if there are good people, you will get the externalities that cause unsustainability and inequality and so on. And it's only through some form of collective decision-making where we say we have to constrain some activities in the market. We have to constrain some impacts on the environment or the economic institutions and behaviours which generate inequality, because we live in a society, that we will do this. And that is called democracy. And that is why a democratic economy is, in a sense, the underpinning value across all of these. Because in the end, we will not get the kind of economy we want by running it through the markets, where the big decisions are made in the markets, because those are the decisions made by the powerful and the rich, and where the externalities occur. So a more democratic economy seems to me to underpin our ability to do all of the above. And then my final point then is about power. Because in an economy that looked like this, you would have a much more distributed system of power. That it wouldn't rest simply with those who are wealthy and who have the economic power and markets and corporations and so on. And power then, the distribution of power, becomes both a feature of a different economic system and how you get there. Because it is a feature of a different economic system to distribute power more widely and to have democratic power, the power of our community, as the guidance for the economy, but it's also how we get there. Because at the moment, power is deeply unequally distributed, and the reason we have an economy that generates unsustainability and inequality and mental health problems and so on is because of the way power is currently distributed. And the way we will overcome that is through democratic processes.
Brilliant.
Thank you.
Thank you, Michael. There's lots to talk about there, but we'll come back in questions. Marta.
Great, thank you. So, as Stuart said, the organisation that I run, the New Economics Foundation, has been arguing for 30 years that the economic system is broken, and that if you want to overhaul the economic system, if you want to achieve rather economic, social, and environmental justice, you've got to overhaul the economic system and the neoliberal free market ideas that underpin it. And for 30 years, this argument is pretty much a fringe argument. It was at the outlier of the political economic debate. Until now. And this is where I think the context is all important. And here I think the UK gives us a fascinating insight into the change that's at foot. So what we are seeing across the political spectrum in the UK is that every major political party is now saying the economy doesn't work. And they're saying this because they're reflecting a deep sense in the country that the economy is rigged, that the system is not on the side of people, and that basic promise that if you work hard, if you do the right things, you'll get ahead, but more importantly, your kids will do better than you, that promise is broken down. And people are understandably fed up, they are frustrated, they are angry, and they want change. And for us, it was this clamour for change and this demand for something better than the status quo that drove the Brexit vote. And it will be the same clamour for change that will get louder and louder as it becomes clear that Brexit is not the panacea that people hope for. Now, how we would just respond to this call for change is going to be the defining political issue for the next decade. Our view is that in responding, the time for making incremental changes to the status quo is over. Public discontent has no tolerance for such tinkering. And so this opens up the space for quite fundamental, and I'd use the word radical change, and a paradigm shift towards new economics that works for people and planet. And we would argue that actually the conditions for such radical change are taking roots in ways that we have not seen before. And it's being driven by the three things that we've been talking about at this conference. So economic breakdown in the wake of the financial crisis, a decade of stagnating living standards. You know, this strange situation where people are told the economy is growing, but they're not feeling the benefits of it, as they're being squeezed as the cost of essential things go up. The second driver, our political breakdown. So this widespread disaffection and distrust in politicians, political institutions, our politics is undermining our democracy, and it's now spreading beyond politics. So a distrust in the media, a distrust in business, a distrust of experts and academia, of charities and civil society, in fact. This sense that there is a detached elite, that is either unable or unwilling to solve the big problems that the country people face. And then the third, and for me the most profound, is the environmental breakdown that others have articulated so eloquently at this conference, that is going to fundamentally change our day-to-day lives, whether we are ready for it or not, in ways that we cannot even imagine. So these three things, the economic, the political, the environmental, are going to come together in a very profound way to drive change over the next two decades. So there is a moment that we have now, and the question is whether we use this moment to shift in a progressive rather than a retrograde direction, where right-wing populists with their easy solutions and their politics that divide will try and take us. If it's going to be the former, then progressives across the political spectrum have got to come together to articulate what an alternative looks like and the route map for getting there. And to then tap into the discontent with the status quo and the desire for change to create a movement that can build power for this alternative. So what does this alternative look like? And Michael sort of set out the framework, and you know, for us, there are six things that we talk about that we think sit at the heart of the new economy, what we call the building blocks of this alternative. And thankfully and helpfully, there's huge overlaps with the four principles that Michael has set up. It'd be a problem if there wasn't. So the six for us are, first and foremost, it has got to be an economy that is rooted in a thriving and healthy environment, in which an urgent green transition is seen as the priority. Second, it has to be an economy that delivers better and more equal living standards, in which the basics for a decent quality of life, a basic income, housing, health and social care, childcare, education, are universal, they're guaranteed for all, and they're provided communally. Third, it's got to be an economy built by thriving business, yes, but businesses that work for the long term and in the public interest, where that sense of social purpose that used to be the hallmarks of good corporation is regained. Social and environmental responsibility, strong voice and power for workers is baked into the business model. Fourth, it must be an economy that gives people more ownership and stake through common ownership of certain public goods and utilities, cooperative mutual ownership of businesses, services, assets and technology. Fifth, it's got to be an economy that's supported and stewarded by governments that are willing to intervene to drive social and environmental outcomes, but where power is decentralized into a strong, active local state rooted in communities with strong democratic participation. And then finally, it's got to be one in which people are given more control and power over the things that affect their day-to-day lives so they can act collectively to improve their lot. So if these are the building blocks, the question is, how do we get there? Now, our view is that we need big, ambitious, radical policies at the national, at the regional, and local level to tackle the big challenges that people are facing in ways that are catalytic in creating this new economy. So using our response to an immediate problem like housing to drive long-term systemic change like shifts in ownership of land. And you know, we at NEF, we have and will continue to develop policies from the Green New Deal to green monetary policy, employer ownership, universal basic services, community housing backed by community land, and the list goes on. But you know, it's not just about new and different policy. We need policy that is made and implemented in a different way. So a new economics of people and planet must be led by those who experience the problems of the old economy most acutely. See, you know, you've got to start with communities. You've got to work alongside people who are at the sharp end, firefighting against a system that is broken, to co-produce solutions to those problems they face that begins to put the new economics into practice, shifting wealth and power to people and their communities in ways that will chip away at the old system. And at the same time, and this is the key point, you create activists, you create voices for change in community after community after community. So the call for new economics is not just the demands of, you know, in our case, a pretty privileged think and do tech based in London, but it's the demand that has been echoed and amplified 1,000 times, 10,000 times, hundreds of thousands of times. And through this process, by organizing people in communities, working with them to develop solutions that bring those six building blocks I talked about into life, and getting them to join the dots between the specific problems they're tackling on housing, on low pay, on fracking, on air pollution, and the system that is the root cause of these problems, we begin to build a social movement that can create momentum, can create power and political pressure for change. If we do this, then, and only then, can we unleash the sort of change that so many of us are desperate to see.
Thank you.
I think they would say bravo to that.
I think by the looks of it, you're going to be in some agreement.
I know, it's all right.
Go for it.
Can I get the PowerPoint up? There you go. So thank you all for that. I'm really glad to be on this panel. And I want to tell you about the work that we're doing briefly at the Democracy Collaborative. Some of you may have heard of this work. It really is our best thinking about actually on the ground in communities. How do we make our political and economic systems more democratic? Some of you may be familiar with our work. A few years ago, in response to all of the analyses that we talk about, concentrated wealth and extraction and things of the like, we coined a term called community wealth building. And it's such a simple concept, but we're starting to see pretty impactful results from the framework. And basically it is, how do you actually get the assets in a local community to actually work on behalf of the folks who live in that community? Novel idea, right? And so, and how do you leverage the economic momentum and consumption of institutions, most of them public, hospitals, colleges and universities, city governments, ports authorities, airports, things of the like. How do you leverage the economic power of those institutions in a way to create local economic progress and prosperity? And so about 10 or 12 years ago, as we were looking around the world for ways to do this, our president, some of you know Ted Howard and Gar Alperovitz, who run the collaborative. Ted took a look at the folks in Mondragon, right, in the Basque region of Spain, where they have an entire economy at the industrial level that's built on cooperative and collaborative principles. And so we're in the business of stealing shamelessly. And so we stole that idea literally from Mondragon and other places, and introduced it to the community here in Cleveland, Ohio. And we started with four anchors there. World-class anchors, Cleveland Clinic, University Hospitals, Case Western University, and I think it's Cleveland State University. And we just asked them, what would happen if you redirected your purchasing, hiring, and investment power toward the communities who are struggling the most? Now you can see in these pictures, these are nice, gleaming, shining buildings, beautiful campuses with water and grass and things of the like, and the community around these campuses were falling down, right? And so it really wasn't just a business challenge, but also it was a moral challenge, right? And so so they took the bait, and out of that, they responded as anchors typically do, right? They said, well, what about a jobs program? And they did that. So the hospitals, for example, started training people in culinary and food services and phlebotomists and things of the like. And now there is a real jobs pipeline. How many times have we been in communities where we do job training, but there's no job at the end of the training, right? And so about 1,000 people from the communities around this campus are now working inside of these institutions, making livable wage jobs, benefits, so on and so forth. But we know that that's just scratching the surface to the point that has already been made. How do we leverage this economic power to create new owners in the economy? And so we invited these anchors to take the additional leap to invest. And over the course of about 10 or 12 years, they've invested with the Cleveland Foundation about $5.8 million to help start up three community-based cooperative enterprises. One is an industrial-sized laundry. One is the largest hydroponic greenhouse in an urban setting, and construction energy retrofit company. And the major customers for these cooperative enterprises, about 300 folks that are running these enterprises, anybody want to guess who the major customers are?
The hospital.
The anchors, right? And so we're making those links between these new owners and these anchor institutions. And so these are livable wage jobs, again, with benefits. And remember, I'm a Baptist preacher, so y'all talk back to me. Everybody say, and.
Amen.
Yeah. Amen. And the surplus or the profit, they now actually are taking that home and putting it in their bank. And so they're part of the ownership class, and people who never had a chance to generate and enjoy the benefits of surplus are doing that. And they're doing all the other things that people need, that the people do with profit. And I will tell you, there's a deeper level of political education that we want to do now with these worker owners so that we make sure we're not reproducing the capitalists that we're actually trying to transform. And so this is how the system works. And then, and so it's happening on various levels in about 35 cities around the country. We're organizing by sector as well, so about 42 of the biggest hospital systems in the country, 33 colleges and universities in 35 cities around the country who are at various stages of this work. And then in 2012, a city in the UK, Preston, some of y'all are familiar with Preston, picked up on this idea. There was a counselor there, Matthew Brown, who met our president, Ted Howard. The city was reeling still after the 2008 collapse globally and looking for a way to move away from traditional models of economic development. They started with 12 anchor institutions who I think in that city generated about $1.2, $1.3 billion of economic power, and they worked to redirect that power toward local businesses. Now, in Cleveland, we started with jobs and cooperative businesses. In Preston, they started as they were redirecting that consumption power to businesses that were already established. And over the course of a couple of years, and I think the rapid scalability of what's happening in Preston is so impressive, is because city governments and the politics line up with the model. And in 2 years, they've been able to reclaim about 480 million pounds that they were spending all over Europe. They're using that to invest in workforce development locally, housing locally, cooperative enterprises locally. They're talking about starting up their own municipally owned bank and municipally owned power source where they're generating their own power. And so the moral of the story here is, I think we're going to be talking about what's missing and what we want to do. What we're hoping to do at the Democracy Collaborative, I think the merging of the organizing that you're talking about and the real pain and aspirations that people are expressing, how do you link that up with this kind of model that could be happening in 10 or 12 places around the globe? We're talking with the New Economics Foundation about a transatlantic relationship to do just that. We're at the last panel of the conference, and we've been talking a lot about how the economy, the political economy operates, how extractive it is of the earth, and so on and so forth. We haven't talked a lot about how it's been extractive of people of color, and of black people in particular. And that's actually troubling, because I think what we're trying to do is talk about how we form a movement together. And if we're not actually talking about reparations, let that sit for a minute. If we're not actually talking about repairing the damage to people, black people and other people of color, that we've suffered at the hands of this political economy, my question to you, and I'm hoping we can dialogue about this,
we will.
Right, is why should we trust you that this is the moment when we should come together when we've been betrayed so many times?
Amen.
And I want to come together. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
I want to come together, but I'm not sure yet. I want to come together, but I'm not sure yet. So we'll talk about the rest in the Q&A.
Great, thank you.
So I cut my political teeth in Chicago. And one of the things, being a stoic Scandinavian, I mentioned this on when I spoke on Wednesday night, you never follow a Baptist minister. You never follow a Baptist minister, especially when you're a stoic Scandinavian. But so as I said, I'm in a business school, but I cut my teeth in community organizing at the University of Chicago. So there was Milton Friedman, there was Saul Alinsky. And so when I'm in the business school, I teach community organizing. Now, that's not what my students think I do, but that's what we do. And that case study that I taught, which some of our colleagues thought, ooh, it's too real, it's too negative. It's forcing colleagues to come together, actually, to find their moral compass. You inspire, you tell the story, you build trust, you take action, you adapt. You're values-driven. We talked about those seven values, the seven C's: candor, compassion, courage. You build that into what you teach business leaders who are passionate about change. Passionate about change. And they believe they can make a difference. And one of the things I wanted, and I'm happy to share the tools that we use because they're action-oriented. And it's about building a coalition. We've got 500 students just in our impact cohort, right? All over the world, 20 countries, yeah, or 90 countries, rather. And one of the things I want to show you is I ask our students to come to class and we begin to map out our community. Who's in our community and who's at the center of the community, right? This happens to be done in India, the organizations that are involved in climate change, with a gender focus, right? So who's there? It's not about you. Often we come into a space and we say, I got a great idea, I'm gonna build on it. The fact is you're not putting the people at the center of decision making. And so we use person at the center. We use the UN human security frame, which is freedom from want, freedom from fear, the eight dimensions of that, of how community is built. And then we map out those partners and how someone begins to work with organizations across that system to partner, to build relationships, to understand impact. Yeah? And you're not alone. So one of the things I ask my students, again, who have investable assets of probably $20 trillion. Now, when you think about climate, SDG 13, just in terms of the Sustainable Development Goals, just in terms of how much money's to be raised, needed every year, it's $100 billion, right? Needs to be raised for one fund. $100 billion, impacting people. How do we make sure that money is deployed in a positive way? So I wondered why I'm in a business school, and it's to teach organizing, community organizing, all over the world. Solomonsky, that's what I was raised in. And how do you do that and create a system? Now, one of the things that my students, the good thing about colleagues in business, especially I'll talk about Tracy, who's from Hong Kong. And she was a four-year-old, and she's at J.P. Morgan. She goes, I want my child to have a future. What can I do? Show me the way. Show me the way. So what I try to do is show them the way. And the way is action. And one of the things that we do is capture the stories that we're talking about right here and teach, turn it into action. So what's happening at this conference, the work that Leslie and her colleagues are investing in, how do we shift from theory to action? And how do we teach that to people who have the resources, the passion, the desire to actually make a difference? This is just one strategy. But mapping out, we all think about, we know what's right, we know what's best. But when you have this map, and again, we do it every community we work in, whether it's in Cleveland or whether it's in Mumbai, who's there to help us? Who can we organize with? And I ask our students, again, these are colleagues from finance, give me one word at the end of the class that symbolizes what you learned. Community, partnership, inspire, truth, courage. Those are values, deep values. So how do we take that passion and convert it to action? And that's what my desire is. And I always ask, why did God put me in a business school, right? And I'm like the angel and the devil, right, on both shoulders, asking the question, what do you believe in and how will you do good? Put the person at the center, ask them. And that case study was about illustration of what happens and what can go wrong when you don't put the center, person at the center. How do we build that relationship? So that is, I just want to show you, I make everybody do this. And if you, unfortunately it's not interactive, but every dot has an explanation of the program,
mm-hmm.
the theory of change, how much money, and their position and why you should work. Right? So it's interactive. So there are other strategies, but this is one. How do we build that community? How do we coalesce? How do we realize it's not, we're not alone? And how do we give hope?
So just very briefly, Leslie asked me to talk about We All. We All is the Wellbeing Economy Alliance, but actually We All works better. And this is a very new global collaboration of organizations, alliances, movements, and individuals working together to change the economic system, to create a well-being economy. And there we're talking about one that delivers human and ecological well-being. We've talked on that quite a lot in this session. The primary focus is the creation of a new power base to exert pressure for change at all levels of the economic system. So at one level, this is mad. This is crazy. But a whole lot of us got together, organizations, individuals, and said, actually, the time is now for something bold to really shift the system, to create power, to shift the system. So the primary focus is the creation of a new power base to exert pressure for change at all levels of the economic system, to crucially, to influence societal habits and norms or values, getting into that issue we've just been talking about, and to support the formation of an effective and dynamic global movement. It's supported by both by the formulation and dissemination of positive new narratives and underpinned by strong and coherent knowledge and evidence base. So if you imagine a tree where the trunk is the power base, the roots coming in are the knowledge they put in an accessible form and the new narratives about what that new economy looks like and how it works. And then hopefully the tree blossoms. But change won't be brought about by any one single entity on its own. So absolutely fundamental to what we believe is that actually collaboration, in the moment we're in, collaboration is more important than agreement. We need to agree on the goals, we need to agree that system change is necessary, but we do not agree, have to agree on all the policies. We need to work together. We're not going to do this without. And that means connecting and amplifying the work of organizations, groups, and individuals striving to build a well-being economy. And we're going to do that by three key organizing methods, creating place-based hubs from the local to the national, which will formulate and implement change in their place. Creating affiliation or sector-based clusters, which develop strategies both for change within that sector and across wider society. And creating what we're calling a We All Citizens movement, which will be focused on ways that people can contribute both in their own locality, but add their voice and their power to something much wider than themselves. And we're a year old. We're a baby. We're building this thing as we fly it. But already we've got 70 global organizations, including the Democracy Collaborative and Next System Project, including NEF, people like the Public Interest Network, which in the US have 1.5 million members in their different organizations, Finance Watch, Global Alliance for Banking on Values, Economy for the Common Growth, the B Corps, the Sistema B, the student movements of rethinking economics, We Africa, Development Alternatives in India, just to mention a few. Pretty widely based, 15 member organizations in the US, but this is growing probably at the rate of 5 to 10 organizations joining a week. A minute. We've got about 40 to 50 place-based hubs in existence, mostly for our existing members. We've got thriving research and business clusters, and about 50 eminent academics worldwide who are participating in this, and are giving their time freely in all sorts of different ways. Laurie, who you heard from yesterday, is one of our research fellows. And we've got a thriving business cluster, I haven't got time to go into it, but we also catalyse a cluster of governments who want to implement a well-being economy. And they've now taken ownership of it, which is wonderful, with the Scottish Government providing a secretariat, and this is called WeGo. Next week, the Icelandic Prime Minister and the Scottish First Minister, together with senior people from the OECD and our hub in Scotland, are meeting in Scotland for the first policy lab of this WeGovernments initiative to look at what a well-being economy looks like in practice. And in September, the first ministers the Icelandic First Minister is hosting the New Zealand Prime Minister and the Scottish First Minister at a wellbeing conference in Iceland. And just think about it, you've got three really powerful new female leaders who are representing, between those three countries, who are representing a different way of doing things. A lot of other countries are looking at coming in, Canada, several others. We've got a thriving and fast-growing youth movement, and yesterday we soft-launched the Citizens Movement, which is going to be on a powerful interactive platform that can immediately connect you to other people doing the same who are in your locality. You can see where they are on the map. You can connect with them. You can join different groups. So that will link very much to our strategy for places like the US, where the idea is to build hubs together with members like Democracy Collaborative and Public Interest Network and many of the others, in particular states, in particular cities, building on what's already there, but bringing all the actors together at the policy level, across business, faith groups, etc., to push for change, whether it's the state or the city level, and at the same time building a citizens network of engaged citizens in that place that are adding their voice and putting their pressure. So this is just one model, but we hope it's a quite a crucial model of actually bringing a lot of the activity together that's going on to create this new power base and to build on all the other great stuff that's happening. So this is nothing about, it's a very small team doing it, but a huge amount of sweat equity from lots of other people going into it. Early days, but hopefully promising.
I just have parting comments. I just wanted to thank everyone, thank all of the speakers who have been amazing. I want to thank the Beckman Center for hosting this. I want to thank UCI School of Social Ecology, particularly John Whiteley, Norma Yokota, and I want to thank the UCI Law School and Melissa Kelly for helping organize all of this. It was a huge job, and for me it was such an opportunity that landed in my lap to put this on, and I'm so appreciative of that. I'm so happy about how this went, and I think it's a great, this whole conference, I think it's a great launch pad for what we need to do. I also want to thank the Marisla Foundation for helping to support this conference. You are always there in the right place at the right time. Thank you. And for everyone in the audience, thank you for coming, and please take this home with you and do something in your own lives.
Thank you.